Okay, so if you could just start by describing a little bit about yourself, a little bit about your background.
Sure. Do you want my name first?
Oh, yeah, sorry. Sure. We're supposed to do the introduction.
Okay, well, I'm Saima Topa.
And I'm Maddie Bullard.
And we're from Rice University with the Houston Asian American Archive Project. And we're here with Donna Cole. Would you like to start off with telling a bit about yourself?
Sure. I'll be 60 next week, so I'm celebrating the beginning of my new life. Mm-hmm. If you know anything about the Japanese traditions and culture, mm-hmm. you'll know that through the Asian zodiac, there's 12 months, right, by mm-hmm. every animal, and I happen to be born in the year of the golden dragon, and this is the year of the dragon, so it's a very special time. So that means that after 60 years, you have actually gone through every cycle 5 times. So that would represent that you've been through water, fire, metal, earth, mm-hmm. etc. Wow. So they say that once you've done that, now you get to start all over in life, and you wear red because red is the color for children. It's a primary color. So I'll be wearing red next Saturday. A little bit about myself. I was born in Denver, Colorado. Mm-hmm. When I was 6 months old, my family moved from Denver as farmers to South Texas. So my dad at the time thought that it would be better to be in the South because you could have 2 growing seasons instead of 1 in Colorado because of the weather. So obviously, you know, you'd have a 50% chance of making a little bit more money for your family, right? Well, unbeknownst to him, Mother Nature wasn't so kind, and there was a drought when they got there. And so my family actually moved from one place to another. We were living in a project. Now that I'm older, my mother actually said we lived in some projects down in the valley, because when they first moved down there, they weren't successful. They went bankrupt as farmers, and so they had to find work elsewhere. And so we moved from one town to another, from Far to Edinburgh, Mission, McAllen. And then I grew up actually in Mission, Texas, and McAllen, Texas. So predominantly Hispanic and white, very few Asians, and very, very few African Americans. So moving from Mission to McAllen, I actually graduated from high school at McAllen High. Mm-hmm. Went to Pan American College at the time. Mm-hmm. Now today it's a part of University of Texas at Pan Am. And I had a great life. I had 2 older brothers, so I was the baby and the only girl, but a great position to be in, right? So I can remember standing next to my father as he was driving the car. And, you know, the boys always had to sit down in the back. So I think that's the special part about being a young little girl, you know, in your dad's relationship. Of course, there was a point in time when I got my first spanking. And I used to run to the door, right, at 5, 6 o'clock in the evening, waiting for him to come home. Well, of course, after I got my spanking, I never came to the door again. Can you imagine? So I never realized how stubborn I was back then. And I wasn't a great student. I was an average student. So I break the stereotypical Asian thought of being good at math and whatnot. So my strengths, which I look back now and I know what they are, back then I did set goals. At an early age, I wanted to be a twirler because we used to watch TV, and at halftime in particular, because I would love to see the twirlers where they were throwing up their baton and turning around and catching it behind their back, you know. And I said, okay, that's what I want to be. I want to be a twirler. So some way, somehow, my parents found a lady to give me a lesson once a week. And this lady, what I learned from her was if you practiced and practice and you got your exercise down right, she would reward you. And so she had this huge bag of candy, and you got to pick out your favorite kind of candy. So you know, time goes by, and I'm still want to be a twirler. I get to junior high school, and what do you know, they tell me if you want to be a twirler in high school, because in junior high we didn't have twirlers, we had a football team but we had no twirlers, right, that you would have to be in the band. So for me, that was a barrier, right, and a challenge. And I thought, oh my gosh, okay, how badly do I want to be a twirler? bad enough that I would use my brother's hand-me-down clarinet and play in the band. Mm-hmm. So then it was a matter of, well, I could just get by and be in the last chair, just so I'd make sure that I didn't flunk out in band. And so my eighth grade year, I was informed that the high school band director actually tells you who can be a twirler or not. He's got to vote. And so I thought, well, all right, this guy is important. So I can't be last chair, because mm-hmm. then they'll know I was just there to be a twirler, right? Mm-hmm. And not there because I like band. And of course, he was a band director and not a twirling director. So I worked hard to get to first chair, second row. Got to high school. They didn't need any twirlers. They had plenty. And it wasn't until my, I guess, started my junior year in high school that, you know, the girls were graduating. And so I had the opportunity to try out and be a twirler. And I was. I made it. Great. My senior year, so I did my junior year. In my senior year, coming off the field, this must have been about the first game of the season, I stepped in a hole and fractured my ankle, and that was the end of my season. So, you know, if I look back now and I think about setting goals at a young age, being determined, you know, that was a 10-year period from the time I was 6 years old till I was actually a twirler, twirling at a football half game, right? So that told me today a lot about myself back then. And that, you know, you have to stay positive, but you really do have to learn in advance and ask the right questions about, what is it going to take for me to get from here to here? Mm-hmm. And I didn't know that, right? So as I was going along in life, I was finding out what I needed to do mm-hmm. to get to my goal. And that sometimes it doesn't happen in your time frame. And you just have to stay positive. And look at the outcome. I had to keep my grades up to stay in band and be a twirler. And then I had to do well in band to be a twirler. So there was a lot of good things that came out of just that one goal. Right? I was also in Scouts. I love Girl Scouts. I think everybody should go through Girl Scouts and Boy Scouts. Because that's another opportunity to learn about those life skills, how to set goals. Right? Look at a badge, decide that's the badge you want, look at the criteria, plan, and get it done, right? Get your reward and recognition at the end of the day. But more than that, it teaches you how to play as a team member, and it also teaches you how to survive on your own. So I just think that there's so many leadership skills involved in scouting that people just miss out totally if they're not a part of Scouts. So what I realized is, when I got to high school, is I like people, I like to do things. So I was ADD electives. So I was in the Future Homemakers of America. I became president. I was in the art club. I was in the Latin club. Now this is band and twirling too, right? And then we also had a little town parade. So, you know, all the students getting together and making their class float. So of course you have to participate in that. And I liked to roller skate. So by the time I got to high school too, we were living in the Rio Grande Valley. Mm-hmm. So Mexico was just 10 miles away. Mm-hmm. So growing up then, you could go across the border on the weekends and drink, dance, right? Have a great time and come back. So I'd like to say that I kind of grew up early. Mm-hmm. Instead of waiting to college to let your hair down, start drinking and all of that stuff, we did it actually in high school. Mm-hmm. So I'm really a lot older than I look. Mm-hmm. But it was a great life. You know, the Rio Grande Valley was small at the time. It was beautiful, lots of orchards, lots of palm trees. The beach was an hour's drive away, and South Padre Island is so beautiful. And then we had Mexico right across the border, so definitely, you know, a different culture right there. And not the same today. It's changed a lot. But that was a good time to grow up. You know, and I guess as a child, I also realized that what other people did for a living didn't impress me. Right? So I can talk to my girlfriends today, and they'll say, oh, well, you know, so-and-so's parents, they own the shoe store, and they own this, or, you know, their parents work for this oil company. And I guess what when I look back at my life, I think, geez, that was never important to me. It was always the individuals. It was the people. Were the people nice to me? You know, were they generous and taking us places and things like that? Not so much or inviting us over to eat. Not so much what they did. So I realized, you know, as an adult, many people define themselves as what they do in their job rather than themselves as a person, which is really a shame. But that's the way life is. We also gave back to the community. My mom was really big about taking me around at holiday time, taking canned goods to people. Even though I realize now we couldn't afford it ourselves, but, you know, that was just built into my mom. And I do that today, you know? So that's a part of me. And so I was also in Candy Stripers, so that's a hospital auxiliary, you know, where you volunteer to work the front desk at the hospital, or you take up flowers to somebody, or they get a card and you take it to them. And then when I started working, my first job was actually my junior year in high school, and I worked at Texas Gold Stamps, and there's also a competing company called S&H Green Stamps. So what you would do is you would go to the grocery store, you would buy your groceries, and for every, you know, $10 of groceries, you get a stamp. And they had these books, and you would lick these stamps and put them in the book to fill the book. Once you filled the book, it took so many books to buy glassware or a sweater or a blanket. And I really loved that job. A friend of mine was nice enough, a friend of the family, to say, yeah, I could work there. So I worked the counter. I also did some stocking. You know, you have to clean the shelves off and straighten up and display. But the really fun part was working upstairs. So upstairs, you would hear the call out for a number. So it could be a 6-digit, 7-digit number. Right, and you'd have to memorize that number and then go run around the aisles and pick up these items, you know, a blanket here, some towels there, and then put them on this conveyor to ship it downstairs. Well, of course, once people looked at it, sometimes they didn't like it, right? So the conveyor also went upwards instead of downwards. So you would have to then find it and put it back. But I remember going home at night and, you know, having numbers written all over my hands. Just because there were so many numbers, you couldn't remember them all. My highest paying job was actually on summertime. So eventually, my dad got out of farming and worked at a bowling center. And I was a pretty good bowler. So I was there a lot with my parents, and they bowled in leagues. And I was asked to teach some young students during the summertime. So I actually made $2 an hour. And I thought that was a big deal at the time. It was not enough hours, though, right? Mm-hmm. So then finished high school. I was an average student. And I started in the summertime going to college at Pan American. And by the time the end of, let's see, so that was the summertime, then the first semester, my dad had bought a bowling alley in Uvalde, Texas. My mom actually worked in the cafeteria. She started at the bottom, wiping floors, cleaning dishes, and worked her way up to be the high school cafeteria manager. So by the time I got to high school, I have to tell you, I had many friends, especially guys, because they'd want to go through the line with me because they would get extra food on their trays, right? So people may say that cafeteria food at their school was horrible. Ours was fantastic. And they made these huge, huge yeast rolls that were just so awesome. I can still smell them today. And so my mom worked there. She also became a nutritionist while she worked there because they were changing food and what they were giving us in terms of so much starch, you know, and getting away from that and a little more healthier in terms of meals. So At that point in time, my brother and his wife from Hawaii, my brother was in the Navy, had come to live with us. So the house was getting a little tight for me. My dad had moved on to Uvalde to start this bowling alley. So I said to my mom, look, okay, I'll go and help him and then you can come sooner. So we did this in stages. So my dad left, went to Uvalde. I went up there and we helped him. It was a bowling alley that was gutted many, many years ago. So it was fun just to see the inner workings of a bowling alley because you never think about the lanes because you just think that they lay them right on top of concrete. Mm-hmm. But there's like 3 feet to 4 feet down below, right? Because you think about the ball return, right? The ball has to come back. And I know today some ball returns, you see the ball actually come back. But this was underneath. And so that was kind of fun to see that and build this bowling alley, brand new. Opening it up. Mm-hmm. And then my mom came. And I stayed there for not quite a year. I did go to South Texas Junior College there. I was very uncomfortable. Okay, so here I am, long hair, down to my waist. I have a Mickey Mouse t-shirt on. I have moccasins and bell-bottom pants. And I walk into my first classroom. And oh my gosh, these are all cowboys and cowgirls. they're in tight jeans with big belts and big buckles and boots, and they have the pointed collared shirts and, you know, the snap buttons. I'm thinking, oh Donna, did you make a mistake? Right. So it was a psychology class. So that was kind of funny because I obviously had different views than they had. And so that was my first computer science class that I took there, and I really liked it. So after that, I ended up leaving Uvalde. It was too small for me. And I told you that I realized later that I liked people. So I moved to Houston. My oldest brother was living here in Houston, and that was in 1971. And I lived with him for a little while. And went to, let me see if I can think of the name of the place. The International School, it was a technical school. Mm-hmm. So they taught you how to program, also to operate a computer system, and also help you find a job. So I finished there. In the meantime, I found a young man who I dearly fell in love with. And because he could read one sentence and expound on it, like he knew it, like the back of his hand, and did research on it for years, it was just amazing. So he and I married. That was John Cole. And mm-hmm. we stayed married for 4 years, had my daughter Tammy, and then divorced 4 years later. But so when I started out in Houston, they found a job for me at J.K. Lasser. So J.K. Lasser was a large accounting firm.
Can you spell J.K. Lasser?
J is in Jennifer. Mm-hmm. K is in Katie. L-A-S-S-E-R. Right? Mm-hmm. So they're an accounting firm, and we worked in the Lax building. So there was a Lax warehouse store, so there's a furniture store.
Is
so
that we L-A-C-K-S?
Right. And so I was the computer operator and programmer. It was cold. Those were those big computers with the raised floors. You freeze to death in there. And so we had key punch cards, and we had these huge reports that we would bring out. And when I would bring out a report to the key punch girls, they knew it was rework because there was something wrong. And so they weren't nice to me. And, you know, I was pretty much alone. So I lasted for 3 months. And I said, okay, I can't do this. This is not the job for me. Mm-hmm. So I was pounding the pavement looking for a job. And in high school, my dad said, take typing, take shorthand, so you'll be a good secretary. Mm-hmm. I also took business math. I did not take shorthand, but I did take typing, so it came in handy, I'll have to say. Because at the time I said to him, well, you know, I don't want to sit on my butt all day long and be a secretary. Well, you know, I'm not too far off. I sit in my office quite a bit. But so I pounded the pavement looking for a job, and I found a job at Lone Star Gas Company. And it was a great company to work for. It was the gas purchases and sales department. And I was the receptionist. Then I was the secretary to the director. And I also did a little bit of lease agreements, some contracts, some letters of intent, and really enjoyed that job. And then I had Tammy. Mm-hmm.
So what year was this all in?
All right, so now I need to back up. So I told you about J.K. Lasser. So I had, also I worked at a jewelry store while I was going to school. So I worked at JCPenney's in their fine jewelry department. Now, JCPenney's didn't own it. It was subcontract, their jewelry department. And I was the best salesman. Rings, watches, I could sell anybody. So that was fun. But then I needed a real job that had lots of benefits, because they had no benefits. You know, you just worked a few hours every night and Saturdays and Sundays, so you really didn't have much of a life if you're in that kind of retail business. But it was nice to have that job to get by while I was going to school. So this was 1972 or 3 when I started at Lone Star Gas Company. And then I left to have my daughter, and when I wanted to come back to work, there was not a position for me, so I needed to look for another job. And it just so happens that we moved back actually to Uvalde for a little while after Tammy was born.
And when was she born?
She was born in 1975. Mm-hmm. The reason we went back to Uvalde is because my parents were there. My brother and his family were there, and I thought it'd be nice to raise a child in a small town. Well, as things turned out, my dad and my husband didn't get along, so I had a choice to make. You know, was it my family or my new family? So the decision was to move back to Houston. So that's when I was looking for another job, and there was an ad in the paper for Gold King Chemicals, Gold King Refining, Gold Rush Drilling, and Hill Petroleum. And they were the fastest growing company in Houston. They were owned by a couple of wildcatters, and they had less than 1% turnover per year. And it was the hardest job that I ever tried for. And they made you take a lot of tests, aptitude tests, Berkman personality test, and it took a month. So finally, after interviewing with HR, you got to interview with the person you were going to work for. So I walk in this office, and it's just the president and his assistant. And she's already gone. So it was just him. So he invited me into his office. So I'm sitting there at his desk, and the phone's ringing. So he's answering the phone, writing down, answering the phone, writing notes, calling people. And just as we get ready to talk, the phone rings again. So he's on the phone, so I just jump up, I go in the other room, and I start answering the phone, taking messages. And I come back, we're getting ready to talk, and it happens again. And as he's going to pick up the phone, I just put my hand on his hand, and I said, look, if you hire me, I know I can save 5 years off your life. Okay. So he hired me. And it was a great opportunity to learn as much as I could about the chemical industry. He was willing to teach me what he knew. He was willing to refer me to people who knew more than he did. I also had lots of reference books. I had the chemical dictionary. I had a chemical flow chart from raw materials from oil and natural gas. I also had a synonyms book. I had the producer's guide, who manufactures what where in the whole world. And I also had another book on the Texas manufacturers. So we sold products like methanol, ethylene glycol, glycol ethers. So these were products going into windshield washer, brake fluid, antifreeze, coolants. And the company was set up to sell BTX, which is benzene, toluene, and xylene, because they were in the drilling, production, and refinery business, right? So they made gasoline and fuels. But on those times when the fuel business was down, right, and they had extra BTX aromatics, they let us sell it for them. So we didn't always have product to sell, so we had to actually find other products. So that's why we sold glycol, methanol. And I looked it up in the chemical dictionary to see what it is, what the in-use applications are, what are the physical properties, how's it shipped, how's it packaged. And then I looked in the Texas Manufacturer's Book to see who was making those products. Mm-hmm. Who was making strippers? Who was making windshield washer? And they would tell you the president's name, the owner, the VP, purchasing person, where they were located. So I would call, because it was the Texas University of Texas Manufacturers Directory. They actually did the research, made sure that all the information was correct, right? So they used students. So I would call and say, hello, I'm Donna Cole, calling from the University of Texas Manufacturers book, right? Just want to verify this information is correct, da-da-da-da-da. 2 weeks later, I would call back because the guy would say, yes, we still make these products, and yes, we still buy methanol, you know, da-da-da. So then when I would call back, I would introduce myself as Donna Cole with Gold King Chemicals. You know, I'd like to talk to you about selling you some methanol. And, you know, he would forget that he told me all that information before. So I always throw a price out there that would get their attention. And then it was a matter of, geez, I wasn't getting orders. How come? Because I knew that was a good price.
So or what kind of price was it?
A lower price than what I thought he was paying.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Right. So, and you could hear papers rattling or desk opening, so you knew he was checking to see, oh, is that a good price or not? Mm-hmm. Right. So I knew they were taking my price and using it with their current suppliers to get the price down. Because they didn't know me from Adam. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So then I realized I had to ask more questions, like, do you have a contract for your methanol? And if you don't, are you willing to buy from me if I give you a competitive price? Mm-hmm. So then the answer would be yes. Or no, I have a me too clause, so a me competition clause. So some contracts have a me too clause in it, so if you give me a price, I have 5 days to go see if my current supplier would meet that price, mm-hmm. or I could buy from you. Mm-hmm. So over time, you learn all these clauses in contracts. And so that's how I was able to build a business. The other thing is to tell them, look, you know, if you ever need product, if your current supplier isn't able to supply you, please call me. So what I realized was I could turn on a dime. I could find product for people right away, especially when there was a shortage, and supply them with product. And also, you know, people want to help other people, naturally. So if I were to call somebody and say, geez, you know, I heard you were the methanol expert. What can you tell me about the industry and what's going on today? Oh my gosh, I got a huge education on methanol. Right? And then you would do it to somebody else just to verify if the information was pretty much the same, right? Mm-hmm. And somebody wasn't pulling your leg. Mm-hmm. So that's really how I got started into the chemical business, because I don't have a chemistry degree or a chemical background. Mm-hmm. So it was just an opportunity at the time when there was a lot of drinking going on in companies, with sales, a lot of golf games, a lot of people taking time away from the business to actually try to develop a relationship with somebody, right? But while they were doing that, I used to say my colleagues, they were out there golfing with one person for 4 hours, and I could go see four people in those 4 hours. Mm-hmm. Right? So that's how I started in the chemical industry. Mm-hmm. And then we wanted to start a warehousing packaging business. And there was already one with a Japanese company in terms of a terminal. Let me stop. And so in this terminal, we went to those owners to say, look, we're ready to also have a warehouse blending packaging business that would add nicely to this terminal that you have.
So did you have a partner at this point? You're saying
at this point, they actually let me buy stock in the company.
And in the company that you were working
right,
for.
Mm-hmm. Because we started another division. So we had Gold King Chemicals, and we didn't start that other company yet. So we had Gold King Chemicals, and they allowed me to buy stock. So I bought 3% of the stock. And then we decided we wanted to be a minority-owned company to take advantage of some of the opportunities to do business with large government contractors. So let's say Exxon, Shell, Procter & Gamble, they have large contracts, over $500,000 contracts with the federal government. So the government said, instead of the big guys getting bigger, how can we increase this economic development pool? Mm-hmm. So what we'll do is, if you have a large contract with me, you should have a subcontracting plan to do business with small businesses, to do business with minorities, women, mm-hmm. now Vietnam vets and veterans, mm-hmm. so that it would be more inclusive, so we can see that economic cycle grow. Mm-hmm. So we said, well, let's take advantage of that. So then we had gone to this company to ask them about being a partner with us to start this warehousing and packaging business. So instead of just being a company who's buying and selling product as a trading company, we would now hold inventory, drum it, blend it, package it, and ship it to customers. And everything was fine. We got to the meeting. We had the agreement. And the last page was the stock distribution page. And they left my name off of it. Mm. Okay. This is 1979. And I said, excuse me, but I don't see my name as an owner. And they go, oh, we're so sorry, but you're a woman. And what's even worse is you're a Japanese-American woman, and we're a Japanese company. We cannot let you own stock. So I said, really? And I said, well, okay, as far as I'm concerned, this meeting's over. And I looked at my two partners, and I said, well, see ya. And they got up and walked out with me as well. That was the end of the meeting and going forward with the warehousing distribution in. And for years I used to say, geez, weren't they great? They supported me and walked out with me. And then somebody said to me later, well, you know, Donna, you were the one who was doing the buying, the selling of product. You were managing the transportation and the tank car fleet. You were doing the invoicing, you were doing collections, you were doing the financial statements. You know, so without you, what were they going to do? Right? Mm-hmm. And I never thought about that. I never thought about, that was the reason why they walked out.
Right? What had been your official position with the company at that point?
At that time, I was vice president of sales.
Mm-hmm. And what was the name of the company that you were meeting with?
I don't think we should say.
Okay, that's fine.
And yeah, you know, in hindsight, I probably could have sued and won. Mm-hmm. But in reality, would that have been good for my career? Because I was just starting out in the chemical mm-hmm. industry, right? And so I was 26 years old at that time. Mm-hmm. And we had customers, DuPont, Shell, Arco, Carbide, all wanting us to have a warehouse packaging facility because they could count those minority dollars. So I was telling our customers, in 6 months we'll have a warehouse. Well, 6 months would go by and we wouldn't have a warehouse. So it's, Donna, you know, where is this warehouse? I went, well, my two partners are at an age where they have kids starting college or in college, and they have a house, and you know, they don't have all that extra cash, and I don't. You know, I just got married. I have a new baby, now 4 years old. And they said, look, if you will start your own business, we will support you and help you get started. Mm-hmm. I went, wow. Hmm. So I thought about it, and so I asked a mentor, and I said, well, what do you think? He said, well, you've been doing all the work. The only thing you haven't done is started a business, and that's really easy. All you have to do is, you know, contact the state, pick out a name, send your $300 in, you know, incorporate, and go down the road. I said, all right, so what about a name? So all night long, I'm trying to think of all these names, right? And so my mentor says, well, how about Fuji Chemical or Fujimoto Chemical? I went, no. Because at that time, there was Japan bashing going on in the automotive industry. And I figured that, you know, that's the last thing that I would want to do is put out a name that people would be offended because it was a Japanese name. So, no. So I picked Cole. And another reason why I picked Cole is because, you know, I had Tammy. I was divorced now. And I didn't want to change my name back to my maiden name. I think some people do that. And what happens is children don't understand why parents are splitting up, much less why would they change their name and not even have the same last name as them, right? So I think there's some dislocations there going on, and I didn't want to do that to her. So I kept the name Cole. She's got the name Cole because I didn't want to have her explain to teachers or friends why her name and my name are different. And it was a good move for us. Started Cole Chemical, worked out of a friend's real estate office. So I naturally automatically had a desk, a copy machine, a fax machine, and started buying and selling. So that was in January of 1980. So I actually opened my doors February 1st. So 2 months went by, did really well, buying and selling product. And all of a sudden, Shell and some other companies that I was buying product from said, okay, you've maxed out on your line of credit with us on your good name. We can't sell you any more product. I'm like, oh my gosh. Okay, what am I gonna do? Well, if you want another load, a truckload of product, you gotta pay for the first one. So right away, I fell into a cash flow situation. Learned about cash flow really quick. So sometimes sales aren't as great as you think if you're not getting paid for it, right? So I realized that the sale's not done until you collect the money. So I had to take on some working partners. Now my mentor at the time, I would have naturally gone to him, right? Except when we were having this conversation about a warehouse and packaging, he said, oh, he didn't want to own inventory or he didn't want a warehouse. That was just too much work. So I never went to him. So I found two other people in the industry, two companies, who said, yeah, we'd be interested in investing in your company. We'll be partners. So there were four partners, and they didn't trust me. So they gave me a working partner. So here's this electrical engineer answering the phone for Cole Chemical out in a trailer on the east side of town in a warehouse. So my first employee was this electrical engineer. Then we hired a receptionist. Then we had to rent forklifts. Then we got to hire some people to run the forklifts and be operations out in the warehouse. So they gave me a $125,000 line of credit. It doesn't sound like a lot today. Back then, it was a lot of money. And I needed that for about 4 months. By the time the summer came, June, July, they needed that money. So they took that money, and I didn't have a line anymore. And I operated the rest of the year. And towards the end of the year, I said, ooh, I don't need them anymore. So I just needed them to get me over that one hump, right? So in November of the first year, 1980, I bought them all out. And I actually borrowed money from my mentor to buy them out, because then he found out. He was like extremely upset that I didn't come to him. Mm-hmm. But that's okay. So over time, I would buy product from him and pay him a little bit more. So let's say the price was a dollar a pound. So I would pay him $1.05 per pound. So that 5 cents extra, he would apply towards that $12,000 that I borrowed from him to pay off my working partners and my other partners. So ever since then, I've been alone. I don't have any other partners. So we've done a lot of things since 1980. So we had a 120,000 square foot warehouse facility off the old Beaumont Highway that we leased. So we were doing drumming and packaging. And this was now 1984, 86, the bottom fell out of the oil industry. And we had a customer where we were Amoco Productions, North American central warehouse location for the whole US, Canada, and Mexico. So we had a lot of product coming through our facility. They had decided to buy their own place. And they gave me a year's notice, and they moved out. So, you know, we had to shrink down from 120,000 square feet down to 30,000 square feet. We also had some other opportunities to start a plant in Corpus Christi for DuPont, mm-hmm. with some initial fill on some barge material. You know, they actually helped us in doing some bagging of dry product. I was trying to push it from a rail car inside the building to a hopper into bags, further than the blowers and pneumatic system could do, right? Because I'm not an engineer. So they gave me some engineers and helped me out. So it was a great time, you know, where people would actually give us net 15-day terms to pay me. So if I had to pay a supplier in 30 days, my customer paid in 15. So that was helping me with my cash flow. Right? Mm-hmm. So there was a lot of things that we could do then. There was other vendors who would give you a discount if you paid a little early. So I worked both sides, which was great to grow. And then in 1986 was my first time I went to Amos Tuck School of Business. And they have a minority business program. It was great. I learned so much about business that I didn't know. And I went back 6 more times. And I also encouraged them to do something with our management team. Mm-hmm. Because I would go to Tuck, learn all of this new stuff that I should implement, come back home, and people thought I was crazy in my business. Like, what is she doing? Don't let her go again, right? Mm-hmm. You know, you would set new strategy, you would do a new SWOT analysis, and you would be changing all kinds of stuff. So so I realized that, and I said, you know, it would be great, Tuck, if you would allow us to bring our management team so that I didn't have to come up here, come back here, and try and regurgitate what I mm-hmm. learned for the last week, right? Mm-hmm. And get people on board. They could hear you. We could stay 2 or 3 days longer and have our own SWOT analysis as a whole team.
Is that SWAT?
Yeah, SWOT.
Okay.
So that's reviewing your strengths, your weaknesses, your opportunities and threats mm-hmm. in business. And then if you look around at your environment and you can visualize what's happening, then you could start to put a plan together, implement it, and by the time you needed it to be in place, it would be in place. Somewhere along the line, through my next 10 years going to Tuck, those six times, one of the professors asked if they could do a case study on coal chemical. So there is a case study out there at Tuck on coal chemical. It was great because it gave me a really good chance to look at the company. Who are we? What are we doing? What's our culture? What's my sacred cows? Mm-hmm. I have a sacred cow. And after all these years, it's the one thing that I haven't given up on. It's when you call here, you will get a live person answering the phone. Mm-hmm. And I can tell you that there's people here who don't like that. They would just rather somebody go into voicemail and pick it up when they want to pick it up. Mm-hmm. Right? One of the other sacred cows when I started was that the corporations asked me to put iron in the ground, have a commitment to grow, hire minorities and women, and give back to community. And after about 4 years, I also realized that it was important for me to not only hire minorities and women, but to do business with minorities and women. and to help that economic cycle. So our first large order was actually a quirk of faith. I mean, we had a global contract we were quoting on in 1986. And at that point in time, it was for 14,000 drums of methanol to go from the United States or anywhere in the world to Cairo, Egypt, to the Gulf of Suez. And at that point in time, there was a shortage of methanol. So even if you were a current supplier of the same product, but that wasn't the issue with your plant being down, okay, you were short because everybody was coming to buy from you. Okay. So now that created a whole shortage in the U.S. product and globally. So the only thing that I did different was ask a question. And the question was, because everybody else said they couldn't do it, because it was in short supply, there was force majeure situations where you have an act of God that under a contract that you can't supply product, then I can't sell it to a new customer. I can only sell to the customers that I've been doing business with that have a contract. And if you have a contract, then you do it on an allocation basis. Mm-hmm. So 1/12 of what you bought last year, you get this year, but every month. So that it's fair.
What's that called? Forced?
Force majeure.
Okay.
F-O-R-C-E-M-A-J-E-U-R-E. Okay. And so the only one question I asked was, well, when do you need it? And they didn't need it right then. They needed it almost 60 days later. Okay. So that meant I had 15 days max to bring in the product and drum it and get it to the dock, and then another 4 weeks to 6 weeks to get it over to Egypt. So if you back out the time on that, you know, when did you actually need the product? It was not today. I had at least a 10-day swing. Mm-hmm. So when I asked our supplier, you know, could they supply, and that was Borden Chemical at the time, they said, yeah, we don't have product now, but in 10 days, we'll be able to produce enough that, yeah, you could buy a barge and a half of product. So a barge and a half of product, we brought in trucks. You know, we drummed it, we palletized it, we capped it, banned it, and sent it to the docks. Now, mm-hmm. it's a flammable product, so it's not like most products where you could just package it and ship it. You had to wait until the ship came in, and you only had the last 3 days before the ship was going to leave to load flammables. Mm-hmm. So all of that was backed out. And so I told my employees, because this was a big job for us, our largest job we had ever had in the history of the company, is that if you work hard, and I'll be right there with you, that we'll pay bonuses. Because we have to finish by X date to make this ship. Right? So that was 11 days of work. And it was almost two full shifts every day, even Saturday and Sundays. So I had even hired friends of employees, children of employees who were like in high school, seniors, you know, they were old enough to work in a chemical facility to do packaging. And one man had twins, a boy and a girl. So they were both working. And I was out there working too. So, you know, we're suited out, we have gloves on, we're filling drums, we're pushing them down the line, putting them on pallets, cutting plywood to put on the top, banding the product, loading it on trucks. And so you can imagine even labeling, right? So you would see people peel off the back of the label and just throw it on the floor mm-hmm. instead of having something on them and just putting it in their apron and then walking over later and putting it in the trash. Because it just meant clean it for somebody else, right? Mm-hmm. Or you could slip and fall on that slick paper. And so the girl, I actually paid her $500 bonus, and I gave her brother $250. So afterwards, he was really upset with me. Miss Cole, why did my sister get more money than I did? I said, because I told you when you started that I would be there working with you guys and watching you, and we would pay bonus based on performance. And I said, she worked harder than you did. You know, I saw him some 20 years later, and he was so grateful that, you know, I actually told him why mm-hmm. there was a difference and how much harder he's working today mm-hmm. than he had ever worked because of that. So when I talk about this minority and women program and how it's part of the economic cycle, that was my first time I realized what the economic cycle was. So remember, I started at 27. This is 1986, so I wasn't that old, right? 31. And I realized that this one job, we bought paper cups, we bought napkins, we bought paper towels, we bought Cokes. So that was part of that economic cycle, right? Not only that, the vendors that we were doing business with on a commercial side, the trucking company, was 150 truckloads of product, you know, in and out. So that helped them and their drivers. The other is that my employees got to make some extra money and a bonus. So one of them was getting married. He paid for his wedding. Another man at the age of 45 didn't own a house. That money that we gave him allowed him to put a down payment to own his first home. It was a very small home. But, you know, that's what economic development is all about. Mm-hmm. And so that was my first real revelation of what it could do.
Mm-hmm. Can you talk about what sorts of community outreach your business does, and in particular if it outreaches to the Asian American community?
It's very broad. Mm-hmm. So what is my outreach in the community? So obviously, since I'm in the chemical industry, we do some things for teachers mm-hmm. To get them out to the chemical plants. So they'll learn what is happening actually in the real world in terms of making chemicals, and then how they're used so that when they go back to the classroom, they can be better teachers. Mm-hmm. And they can also tell their students, you know, if you decide to pick a career in this area, here's the job opportunities for you. So we do that. We support the chemical industry also through political action committees, doing some lobbying. We also support children and youth. So we started a pipeline for the sciences in underprivileged areas, because usually they take the high school, I mean, not the high school, but the junior high coach, and they want him to teach chemistry. Mm-hmm. And so it's really hard for kids to get a grasp of it. Mm-hmm. So what we do is on a Saturday, they do a round robin, 8 hands-on experiments for 4th grade through 8th grade, mm-hmm. which is fabulous. And then we take high school chemistry students to actually help the students, and then we're just there in the background to assist. We have a little chemical show, so you can see what happens with nitrogen, with the banana, you know, and once you put nitrogen on a banana, then it's hard, and then you can throw it and it just cracks and shatters into all kinds of pieces. We also let them watch a video on the chemical industry, because a lot of people say, oh, we don't like chemicals, but what they don't realize is water is a chemical. Mm-hmm. Right? So as basic as that, and we bring it forward to medicine, you know, hair care, all kinds of things, how you use chemicals in your everyday life, even building a car and the fuel, so that people are more aware of what they're about. So also minorities and women in business. So I mentor a lot of people in business. And with the community, so I'm on the Women's Home mm-hmm. board. They actually bring in women who've lost everything mm-hmm. at this point, whether it's an addiction to drugs or they're battered or whatever it might be. And they have an 86th percentile success rate if the woman stays there for at least 6 months. So it's only for an individual who's had some issues. So they get them off the drugs. They give them health care, mental health care. They also teach them skills, typing, computers. They have a resale shop, so they can actually learn how to sell, set up the display, do the inventory. And so I just think it's a really well-rounded program. They also have built a apartment complex to get these women going. So some of these women are nurses, and once you're a nurse and you've started taking drugs and they find that you've done this, and you can never go back and be a nurse again. And many of them do it because they want more money for their families, right? They want their kids involved in this organization or that organization, mm-hmm. this sport, playing piano. And before you know it, they're working two shifts. And in order to work two shifts, they have to take uppers, and then they have to take downers, right? And then it just becomes a vicious cycle until they lose it all. So now they have a place to stay at their home, for the women's home that they've built, and they get them a job. Mm-hmm. Because what happens is, once you're at a point where you lose everything, and you know, just getting started, it's hard to have enough money to survive for food. Then you have car, insurance for their car, the fuel, a place to live, you know. So things start building up. So even if they had a minimum wage, they can't make it alone. They still need help. So that's probably one of the areas that I think there could be a lot more capacity built for them. I do a lot of speaking. Yesterday I just spoke to an 8th grade graduation class. It was really fun. In the Asian community, so I'm a member of the Japanese American Citizens League, and also it's the Asian Pacific Heritage Society. I donate to all kinds of Chinese community center events, to the Chinese Citizens League, to the Miss Chinatown pageant, Dance for Asia, also involved with the Museum of Fine Arts Houston. They just built an Asian gallery, mm-hmm. so they have a Japan gallery, so we've donated there. There was the Asia House. I don't know if you've been there yet, but it's fabulous. And so Asia House has just been built, and it's down in the Museum District. Mm-hmm. And so it's for all the Asian communities in terms of culture, education, mm-hmm. business, politics, for that U.S.-Asia relations. So if people don't know enough about Asia, they can go there and learn a lot about Asia. So they have lectures, and they have an auditorium. They also have an exhibit area mm-hmm. from the Rockefeller Collection. I'm helping with the veterans, the Japanese American veterans in mm-hmm. World War II. Many people don't know that there were Japanese Americans in the U.S. Army, and my dad happened to have been in the 442. Mm-hmm. So it was tough growing up in a small town. Got teased a lot for being Japanese, and I always hated it when December 7th rolled around because of bombing of Pearl Harbor. And kids can be mean to other kids in a way where, yeah, I just didn't want to go to school that day. But you go to school, and I always thought, geez, when the time comes for show and tell, I used to take my dad's 442 book to show that my dad was in the U.S. Army. You know, now, today, it gives me great pleasure to say I worked on getting them the Congressional Gold Medal. So that's the highest ranking Congressional Medal that you can get in the United States. And they were just recognized this last November wow. in Washington, D.C. So the next piece is that there's going to be a trial and exhibit through the United States, mm-hmm. and we're going to have an interactive iPad, iPhone exhibit for them. So people will know about the Japanese-American plight in the United States, the discrimination that they fought, but at the same time, the loyalty and the courage that they showed, mm-hmm. and what citizenship meant to them.
Can we speak more about your ancestral heritage and perhaps sure. The story of your family's migration from Japan?
Okay. So my grandparents came to the United States. So my grandfather mm-hmm. on my dad's side mm-hmm. actually was a stowaway on a ship. So he was 10 to 12 years old is all we can figure. And somebody said to him, he said, well, I want to go to the United States because, you know, America, you know, that's a place that you can go and things will be better than Japan. But, you know, at that time it was really hard for a lot of countries in the mm-hmm. terms of depression and people starving. So one of his uncles said, well, if you want to go, go. So here this kid runs and gets on a boat, and he's close to the United States, and it was almost in Mexican territory, and they found him. So he was running for his life. They shot at him. He jumped ship and swam ashore. And that happened to have been Baja, California. Mm-hmm. So down at the tip in Mexico. family took him in, and he was actually a houseboy, and he did chores around their ranch. Mm-hmm. And when he got to be about 15, 16, the family thought he was such a good worker and a nice guy, and he learned Spanish, that maybe he should marry one of their daughters. Well, he decided that he was too young to be married, so he left, and he came to the United States and crossed the border into California, and then wrote for my grandmother to come. Mm-hmm. So she came, they had my dad, and then they moved to Colorado. Mm-hmm. So that's my dad's side. On my mom's side, my mom's father is an only son, and in Japan, the oldest son gets the burden of the family and the parents. But him being an only son, they didn't want him to go into the military because he would have been, they were landowners, and he would have been in the kamikaze pilot area flying. So as you know, kamikaze pilots, they teach you how to fly it, but they don't teach you how to land it. They only teach you how to crash it. And they just couldn't see that for their son. And so they said that they wanted him to leave. Well, he married my grandmother, and they had a daughter. So he said, okay, he would leave. And this daughter actually was 10 years old when they decided to come to the United States. Mm-hmm. So my grandfather actually came earlier through Hawaii, working on the plantations, and then came through California to Nebraska and worked on the railroads. And then he went back to get his wife and his daughter. Mm-hmm. And she was 10. And imagine that they would give you a choice to stay in Japan or come with them to the United States. Mm-hmm. And at the time they said, if you come with us, you know it's not going to be easy. Or you can stay here with grandmother. And so she stayed with grandmother. They came to Colorado, and they had the rest of their family. So they had my mother and three boys. Mm-hmm. And my family is very interesting in Japan. So when we do the family tree, it looks like cousins are married to cousins, but they really weren't. So if you would go back to my great-grandparents on my dad's side, they actually were divorced. So, but they had one child. And then when they divorced, they married two other people. And then they had their children, say 9 to 11 kids. So you always had a lot of kids, so you can work that farm or whatever you were doing, business. And then those children met each other and married. Right? So they weren't really from the same family, so it just looked that way on paper. In Japan, if you don't have a son to carry on your name, you can ask somebody who has more boys and ask for that son to become your family. So then all ties are broken off. So if the son says yes and the parents say yes, then that son will come to my family and take on the Cole name. Mm-hmm. Right? So that happened in my mother's family. So when I went to Japan a couple years ago, I tried to look up some family members, and this lady was not very nice to me. She says, well, you know, you're not really part of our family. He was, but now he's, you know, my husband's not, and he's dead now, so I really don't have any connection with your family. I'm like, okay, fine. So she put me in touch with another aunt. She said, but this other aunt, she's your real aunt, and she would like to see you. So I thought that was kind of interesting. So in terms of being in Colorado, Governor Carr was the governor at the time after World War II and the internment of the Japanese. So he actually invited Japanese to come to Colorado instead of going into the camps because he wanted he wanted the people there. He wanted the people to farm the land and to grow the state. So there is a huge population of Japanese in the Denver area. Now, mind you, when he was up for re-election, he did not get re-elected. It happens to so many people, that you do what you think is morally correct and the right thing to do, but other people have different ideas because of discrimination.
So, can you say this again? He offered Japanese Americans to go to Colorado mm-hmm. instead of being
interned,
mm-hmm. and that was a possibility for
yes.
their family.
Yeah, so there was a lot of people mm-hmm. who moved from California mm-hmm. to Colorado.
Mm-hmm. Wow. And, you know. Was your family interned?
No, my family. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Oh. Thank goodness, because we were in Colorado.
Okay.
But even being in Colorado as a Japanese American, you couldn't go more than 2 miles from your house without FBI approval. Okay, so you got to know your neighbors, and if you needed bread or sugar or things like that, you know, you would ask them to buy for you. And there was a lot of bartering going on in those days, right? So my dad's family had cattle and grew crops. My mom's family did not have animals, livestock. So, you know, you would swap products with each other to be able to survive.
Mm-hmm. What approximate time period did your grandparents migrate?
I think it was around 1902
okay.
is when my mother's side came through, and of course my other grandfather, he was here much earlier mm. than that.
Wow.
You know, he probably came in the late 1800s.
Wow. So, did you speak Japanese at home, or did you learn Japanese when you were a kid?
I wish. Okay, so yes, they sent me to Japanese school on Saturday, but that was the last place I wanted to be. Mm-hmm. So, but I did like the arts and crafts and the dancing mm-hmm. and the food, but so I wasn't that great a student. But if you can imagine, my grandparents, when they came here, they were very young. So the language has changed a lot mm-hmm. and evolved. So if somebody were to hear some of the words that I speak, so I tell people that I'm from the Meiji period as a three-year-old. I can't put sentences together yet, but I can tell you what an object is mm-hmm. in Japanese. And I'm sure with my Texas accent, it doesn't sound right anyway. Mm-hmm. But they spoke Japanese, my grandparents, and then, of course, my grandfather could speak Spanish, too. Mm-hmm. Their English wasn't very good. Mm-hmm. They mostly spoke Japanese. So my parents can speak Japanese and can still write in Japanese. But when the war broke out and Pearl Harbor happened and the internment happened, so imagine that you can't speak Japanese mm-hmm. in public because you would be sent to an internment camp, right? Or at least investigated. So when that happened, they took everything and burned it. So any pictures of Japan, any writing, any pictures of the emperor and the empress, books, all of that was burnt. I have one thing from my grandmother, and that's a instrument, and she hid that under her bed on the loose floor. So when the soldiers and the FBI came through for many of these Japanese, some of them saved their family sabers, the mm-hmm. Samurai swords, but they were all confiscated and never returned. Mm-hmm. Okay. So oftentimes I go to houses and I see these samurai swords at someone's house, and I'm wondering, is that mine? You know, should that be at my house and not theirs? But they didn't speak Japanese to us. It was important for them to have us be totally entrenched in the American mm-hmm. lifestyle and not to speak Japanese. So, unfortunately for many of the Japanese, they don't speak mm-hmm. their mother tongue.
For self-preservation.
Yeah.
How do you self-identify culturally, like as Japanese-American or just as American?
All right. First, I'd have to say American and then mm-hmm. Japanese. Mm-hmm. Okay, so woman, right? American, Japanese, American,
uh-huh.
yeah, and Asian.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, all of those in there. And then minority, just because from a female standpoint and from my ethnicity standpoint also.
Do you feel that your status as a minority businesswoman has affected your trajectory or path in the business world?
Double-edged sword. Yes. You know, we have started our business because of it. We're probably still in business because of it. And it really is a foot in the door. So to open that door wide open, you really have to show that you're honest, hardworking, and that you're going to deliver and responsible. Right? So I feel like that we've done that. Is there a lot more business that we could have access to that I think some people pigeonhole us? Yeah, I think so. But that's just, that's the life I've chosen.
I had one question. If I'm not mistaken, you recently received the Joseph Jaworski Leadership Award for Distinguished Public Service. Could you describe a little bit about that award and what it means to you?
That is a very significant award because in 30 years, I'm the first Asian and the first female Asian to receive this award. Now, in terms of how many women have gotten it in the past, it's very small. There's been one Hispanic woman who's received it in the past, but usually it's been a white couple. So to say that the Joseph Jaworski Award is all about community, about leadership, and not just what I do with my company, but what I do personally and with others, I think it just speaks volumes for this award. So I was very touched. Yeah. So at first, when they announced it, I had that Asian instinct to say, no, there's somebody else out there who's better or should deserve to get it this year and not me. And then there was a little voice in the back of my head that 2 months earlier, somebody sent me an article about why Asians don't excel as fast or as well as they should.
It's in terms of a glass ceiling?
In terms of the glass ceiling, yes. But it's because that they're modest and, you know, they're not out there showing themselves, and they would like to see other people be raised up and get that award rather than themselves, because that was the culture that we were brought up in, is a culture of respect. You don't speak out, you know, you're quiet as a mouse. Right, you're to be seen and not heard, and you don't brag. So, you know, it's very hard, I think, for Asians to recognize that and to change. I think they do try to change, but sometimes it comes off as not real. And so I think we just have to work on that a lot more.
Do you think that those instincts have hindered you in your business ventures?
You know, I'd have to say yes, but you can't redo history. So all I can do now is say, okay, now I recognize some of the times when I should have spoke up and I didn't. Today I'm a much different person. You know, I think it's also a matter of maturing and your comfort level with yourself and who you are, to be able to say, oh, geez, is that really right? You know, is that the right thing to do? Or is there a better way? Are there better words, better thoughts we could use? And how can we change?
Compared to when you were a kid, are you a lot more comfortable with identifying yourself with your Japanese heritage now? Or as an Asian American?
Oh, absolutely. I used to be ashamed of who I was or what I looked like. Okay, not who I was, but what I looked like. So now, yes, I've embraced it. It took me a while, and actually it took me going to an Asian Pacific Women's Leadership Institute. I never thought I needed it, and then Judge Hannah Chow said, you need this class. And I said, okay, so it was a full year of 4 weeks of training. Right? And in that training, they actually take you all the way back to your first memories of those tough times and trying to help you get through them. And what do you need to address? And what do you need to go back and address to somebody else, right? Of how you felt, how you were treated, et cetera, in your family. And then moving forward. So it's about now, instead of assimilating, is how do I integrate myself into society, into business, into work, and at home, and yet still maintain who I am at the core, so that I don't have to leave anything at the door, that I can bring my whole self into this room and have a great conversation with you, and not feel bad about any part of me.
I actually just had one last question. I was wondering, what areas of Houston have you lived in since you moved here? And could you describe a little bit about the differences maybe in those neighborhoods that you've lived in?
Sure. So when I first moved here, I lived off of Rittenhouse in 45. Mm-hmm. Predominantly a low to middle income area. Mm-hmm. And I lived there for probably a year with my brother, and then I got married, and we moved over to Gessner and I-10, which was all brand new, new apartments. It was a Harold Varb apartment, so it was an upscale area for me. Then I realized that my husband had debt from his previous wife, that we couldn't pay all the bills. So you paid somebody this month and doubled up on somebody else next month and then paid somebody else. And I realized that between what he made and what I made, there was no way we could make these monthly payments and stay where we were at this new Harold Varb apartment complex.
Could you spell that last name?
Farb, F-A-R-B.
Okay, thank you.
And we moved to right off of downtown at Memorial and... what was that? I guess now it's called that new vibrant area of town. Oh, what is that?
Montrose?
Well, not Montrose. It's a little bit Heights.
Heights, yeah.
Right? Mm-hmm. Right in that area. So we were off of Memorial in Woodway at Washington.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So it was an $80 a month house. You can imagine. I packed up everything, put it in boxes, and who knew they had termites? Right? 6 months. And so I said, okay, for 6 months, we're going to live here so we can save money and pay these bills off, and then we'll move. Well, you know, what I didn't realize was he was a big spender.
Mm-hmm.
So he was buying custom knives and pipes and a motorcycle and a dog. He paid $400 for a St. Bernard. Who in their right mind has a St. Bernard in Houston, Texas, right?
Mm-hmm.
So the St. Bernard, we had him tied up outside the garage. So we just went four blocks down the street to this little Birdsall grocery store and came back, and the dog was gone. So we decided to go around looking for this dog. So one block behind me, it was row houses. So I was so surprised. So, you know, a lot of African Americans there. Mm-hmm. And you could see inside the house. You know, they had no air conditioning. I thought, oh my gosh. You know, we were living right on the edge. And it took me back to South Texas days. You know, going to where my mother had me deliver canned goods. You know, where we were going around donating money and canned goods to people. I just thought, wow, you know, I had no idea that was the area of town we were living in. So we ended up about 12 months later moving from there, and they had termites. So they were eating through my boxes and eating my books. You would literally open up a book and just the pages would just fall out in dust. It was unbelievable. And we ended up moving to Bel Air because he grew up in Bel Air. And many people don't know, but that Bel Air area, when it was just being built, they had a lot of porous sand, so quicksand.
Mm-hmm.
And then they just kept putting dirt in there. So that's why that whole area is kind of funky. Anyway, so we moved to the Bel Air area, and that was middle income area. You know, it's kind of nice, little restaurants in there. A&W root beer, some pizza joints, and some hamburger joints. So that was fine. I rode a motorcycle at the time. So I'm in the Women's Museum in Dallas. There's a row of us with the Houston skyline behind us, and we're all on our BMW motorcycles, all women. But where else did I live after that? Oh, well then, when you get married, right, you need a house. So we moved to Katy because Katy, you could buy a house at a decent price with lower taxes, good school district for babies if you were planning to have a family. So we moved out to Katy. So that was very different, you know, moving into a new house with no grass, you know, no trees. And then, Jews. So after that, in 2000, I moved back here into Houston. So right off of Eldridge and Memorial. In a nice neighborhood. Gated community now. You know, very different.
So is the neighborhood that you live in now, what's the diversity like in that neighborhood?
It's very diverse. You know, so our neighborhood, we have African Americans, we have Asians, we have people from Great Britain, people from Venezuela. Oh, gosh. Yeah, the neighborhood is just really dynamic. Lots of fun. In the neighborhood here, you have all kinds of different food.
Yeah.
You know, from Vietnamese to Japanese to Thai. We have Mexican, we have Italian, we have the Venezuelan restaurant now. So it's pretty cool. Indian.
Well, thank you for your time, Donna Cole.
Yeah,
you're welcome.
Thank you very much. It was a great interview. So,
yeah. Really,
you
learned a lot
it.
About me.
Yeah,
there's so much more you didn't ask about the business.
Yeah.